I'm Coco Novak, author, show host, and public speaker. Welcome to season two of The Coco Novak Show. In this season, we're going to delve deep into what makes us human, relationships, stories of failure that we learn from, and stories of success. It's going to be real, raw, and relatable. So stay tuned, hit that subscribe button, and enjoy. Hi, James, and welcome to Tuesday Talks.
Hi, Coco. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. How are you doing? I'm so excited about our conversation today.
I'm good, thanks. I'm just as excited as you, I think.
Today, we're going to be talking about ADHD, more specifically adult ADHD. And Professor James Brown, you are the co-founder and chair of ADHD Adults Europe, UK. Co-founder and co-host of ADHD Adults Podcast. You're a public speaker, BBC advisor, and advocate for change in ADHD. So that's kind of what you do right now. Would you like to give us a little bit more about your background?
Yeah, so I spent 20, 25 years in academia, did a degree and then a PhD, and then went on to become a lecturer and then a professor in biomedical science, so health and disease effectively, and had, I think, what most people would call a relatively successful career, but was very unhappy. And I was lucky enough in the last maybe 6 or 7 years of that time to become a science communicator, to start working with the media to communicate science. And I was much happier with that. And that led me where I am, you know, really today in terms of my work with ADHD, was that kind of training as a science communicator, as opposed to just being somebody in a lab playing with cells in a test tube.
Yeah, likewise me. So as we'll be talking about ADHD today, why don't you tell us a little bit about your childhood and kind of, were there signs of ADHD then? Were you diagnosed as a child, or what did that path look like for you?
It's interesting because looking back, the signs were all there, really. I can remember specifically going to the doctor with my mum when I was 8 in 1983. And I can even remember the phrase the doctor said, "He's hyperactive, Mrs. Brown, but don't worry, he'll grow out of it," which was a lie. I didn't. And when I look at my behavior, it was relatively typical of either a boy or a girl with ADHD. So I was hyperactive, which you see more often in boys, but I was also very internally distracted, daydreamy, slightly anxious. And if you look at my school report cards, which I found a couple of years ago, most of them would say something like, "James is relatively clever," or "James is able, but he needs to focus," or "he needs to concentrate." And these are the classic signs of ADHD in childhood, of that inability, even in a structured environment, to do what children are expected to do, which is to sit still, to listen, and to behave. So there were lots of signs there. But when I was a child, you couldn't be diagnosed with ADHD in the UK by the NHS. That wasn't available till the year 2000. So it really wasn't a thing in medical terms in the UK until I was already an adult.
Interesting. Do you think that the school system pushes children, and maybe especially boys, which we know mature a little bit later than girls, do you think they push them too quickly to be still, to sit for a prolonged period of time? And does that kind of maybe kickstart it a little bit sooner as well? Should kids be playing longer, basically, is the question.
If you look at educational models that are more successful, particularly the Scandinavian models, then that's what they do, is they start school later. They focus on socialization and play first before they start academic work. In the UK, we follow a more typical American model, which is to start school around the age of 5 and to standardize, test children every year, and to have what we call a national curriculum. And that means the subjects that are delivered have to be delivered, core subjects across the different stages of education. And I think whilst there have been great changes and improvements in terms of supporting neurodivergent children who have a diagnosis, it's an environment that isn't conducive to children with ADHD, particularly if they're undiagnosed, because of what you said. We're expected to sit still for long amounts of time, to not interrupt to maintain focus on something without glancing out of the window or daydreaming. And all of those things are, for many people with ADHD, core traits and symptoms which we've got.
Yeah, very true. So talk us about, or talk us through, when you finally got diagnosed.
So it's quite an old story, this. I'd known for probably 6 years before my diagnosis that I had ADHD. My co-host on the podcast and co-founder of the charity, Alex Connor, he phoned me up one day and said, I've just been diagnosed with ADHD and you're way more ADHD than I am. And we laughed and thought, okay, I'll do the online tests, and did all the online tests, and they all kind of screamed high likelihood of ADHD. And I just did nothing with that information. I actually helped a colleague get diagnosed before me by saying to him, it sounds like you might have ADHD. And the reason for that was twofold. One was I thought I was doing well. I thought, well, I'm being promoted at work. I'm a senior lecturer, and then I'm an associate professor, and things are going well. But internally, my mental health was really poor. I was having to mask and hide all my symptoms. I was having to work long hours, 6-7 day weeks, and I was very unhappy. And then when it came to the pandemic and the second lockdown period in the UK, which was during the autumn and the winter, so it was dark, and as a university lecturer, all the teaching had moved online. So I was spending every day sitting in front of a computer screen, you know, just talking at the screen because students didn't really talk back. And that period of about 12 weeks really made my ADHD symptoms more prominent. And I really started to struggle with my mental health as well. I also have a form of bipolar disorder. And it got to actually Christmas Day. And Christmas Day 2020, I remember sitting staring at the wall thinking, I don't feel like I've got a future. And at that point, the close people around me said, you need to get a diagnosis. You need to get help with this. So I paid to get a private diagnosis in the UK. And I think it was February the 6th, 2021, I got my diagnosis. And that, as a pivot, as a change point in my life, it's one of the most important days of my life because it's changed everything.
Wow, that's amazing. What did it change?
The first thing it changed was my identity, because I described myself internally and often externally for years as flaky, unreliable, lazy, make lots of mistakes, not as good as everybody else, would wonder, why can't I do this thing that I could do last week, but now I just can't engage with it? Why is it that I struggle to hold down friendships? Why is it that I really struggle with rejection, which is a kind of a non-diagnostic symptom of ADHD. So the first thing it did was it allowed me to drop some of that baggage and accept that there's a reason that I sometimes make mistakes and I'm sometimes unreliable and et cetera, et cetera. The second thing it gave me was support in the workplace, because ADHD is a protected disability in most countries. It is in the UK. And that meant my employers had to support me legally. And it gave me access to medication. And in my case, medication has been very effective. So I went from pre-medication, just really struggling at that point to engage with work, to after medication, being able to get up in the morning and start work and be, you know, pretty functional on most days.
Wow, amazing. Really good. Does adult ADHD differ from child ADHD?
That is such a good question. And I think it has an answer which would take the entire length of this podcast. It kind of does and it doesn't. So typically, boys and girls have slightly different symptoms, boys being more externally hyperactive. And what we tend to see is that hyperactivity can reduce as we age, as we get older. The core symptoms of kind of inattention generally don't change, but we do start to see some issues in later life as we grow up with the emotional side of ADHD. It's a part that most people don't realize is part of ADHD, is regulating our emotions. So we do see subtle changes, and that's as a group, but also as individuals. But the core symptoms are normally there and remain there until we're adults.
Interesting. So how does an adult get diagnosed? Do they just go to the NHS and they get diagnosed?
Oh, I wish. So again, it has to be diagnosed in the UK, normally by a psychiatrist. Technically, the wording in the NHS guidance is a psychiatrist or other qualified healthcare professional. In the UK at the minute, the waiting times for an assessment. So you go and see your family doctor, your GP, and hopefully you would say, I think I might have ADHD. And then they would refer you to a specialist psychiatrist for an assessment. Because of the, I suppose, the lack of preparation for ADHD. In the UK, some people are waiting 7 years to get an assessment. In some areas of the UK, there was a recent piece of work. So in the Sheffield area of the UK, there are 6,600 people on the waiting list. And in 2023, they did 3 assessments in the whole of the year. So the NHS system is how people should go for a diagnosis. But at the minute, there is just this huge lack of supply for the demand. So yes, the journey, if you like, is go and see your family doctor first, ask to be referred to a specialist psychiatrist, and then in most cases, wait and see when that assessment is.
Wow, that's the backlog.
There was a statistic that the BBC did a really good piece of work recently, and I think there was a statistic that it would take, you know, to clear the current backlog at the current rate, more than 80 or 800, I can't remember years, but it has to change because there are so many people in the UK, probably 1.5 million adults with ADHD, probably 90% of those are undiagnosed, and we just don't have the resources to help these people get help in a reasonable time frame.
Wow, that's mind-blowing, actually. So what are the common misconceptions about adults with ADHD?
That's a good question. I think there are lots of them. That firstly, that the adults can't have ADHD. That's a very common misconception, that it's a disorder of young boys specifically. That's the view that most people in society, understandably, because until the last few years, it's not really been on the agenda. That's most people's view. So a common misconception is that adults don't have ADHD. Another common misconception is that women don't have ADHD. Another one, which is really frustrating, is now it's finally getting recognized, is that it's a bit of a trendy bandwagon and people are jumping on it to either kind of get help from work or get access to medication, or because, you know, it's some kind of badge that they can use. And the amount of myths that lead to societal stigma are astounding, really, because that lack of societal understanding and acceptance means that trying to explain to somebody that doesn't really understand ADHD that, yes, you can be the head of a company, a director of a company, you know, a professor, you can be incredibly successful and still have ADHD, which is the final myth that's worth talking about. And I've heard of lots of people who've gone to see their doctor and said, I think I've got ADHD, and been told, but you've got a degree, or but you've got a really good job, you know, you don't have ADHD. And it's just so damaging, because it's not true. You can be as successful as, you know, you want or are able to if you're working in the right field with ADHD. It in itself isn't a barrier to success. It's the lack of support to ADHD that's often a barrier to success.
There's actually interesting statistics, which I pulled out. So most entrepreneurs have some form of ADHD. And people with ADHD are 500% more likely to be entrepreneurs. And it's estimated if 4 or 5% of the general population has ADHD, about 20 of those are entrepreneurs. So it's not that uncommon that they would be leaders in their fields.
It's not. It's the positives, if you like, the strengths of ADHD. It's a very controversial area. But it's a good opportunity to communicate the fact that even though people with ADHD are neurodivergent, and that means that our brains have developed just slightly differently, even as a group, we are diverse. So there are people within that group that are incredibly good at artistic crafts, or incredibly good at working in certain areas, and others that aren't. You're right, there is evidence that people with ADHD are more likely to be entrepreneurs. If you dig into that evidence a little bit deeper, it's people with ADHD who have impulsive symptoms, which is one side of ADHD. It's linked in with hyperactivity, and it's usually later in life. So what that means is that people who get to a point in their life where they're either unhappy with their current state, or they really, really want to do that thing that they've always wanted to, will then be the catalyst for starting a business. So it is definitely a strength for some people with ADHD, but it's not a universal strength, but it's something that can be a real advantage if you're trying to develop, create a company, create a niche for yourself, and you have different way of thinking, for example.
Yeah, we have the other spectrum, the other end of the spectrum. Among those in custody, up to 30% of young people, they've been found to have ADHD. So it's five times more than the general population. And then this escalates to tenfold increase in prevalence among imprisoned adults, which is 26.2%. What does that tell us?
It tells us that historically, over the last 20 or 30 years, the lack of support for ADHD has been a contributing factor. There's a study which has looked at called a meta-analysis, where you look at all lots of different studies and gather that data together. And yeah, in UK prisons, the inmate population, it's 30.2% have ADHD symptoms sufficient to be diagnosed. And for many of those people, an early intervention, so diagnosis, for example, when they were children, and support would have had a positive impact. We know this from studies where children are diagnosed and supported, and they have better outcomes, less risk of being involved in the criminal justice system. So there's a generation, and possibly generations, of people who, because they didn't have access to diagnosis and support, and because some of the traits of ADHD can involve risky behavior, can involve impulsiveness, we're more likely to have substance use disorders. So we might get involved in, you know, abusing illicit substances. There are so many different manifestations of ADHD that could lead you down that path in the wrong, the right or the wrong circumstances, that it's something that I get very passionate about. I've got a friend who works for the Metropolitan Police, running something called the ADHD Alliance, and they're trying to support both officers, but also to change how ADHD is managed. They've produced guidance, for example, for the custody suite, which custody suites should use if they suspect somebody might have ADHD. It's what it is. It's a terrible statistic, but it's also an opportunity for change. We really need to start supporting these people. And there are some schemes in the UK where they are assessing and supporting people in the prison system who have ADHD, but they're few and far between.
Interesting. So are there differences between men and women, either in prevalence or outcomes with ADHD?
It's a good question. We're limited by the science. And if you go right back to the diagnostic process for ADHD, the test for ADHD was designed in boys, predominantly white boys. And therefore, we have a test which is designed to pick up how ADHD manifests largely in boys. And because there are those slight differences I mentioned earlier, boys are generally, but not always, more hyperactive, more behaviorally challenging, and girls are generally, but not always, more introverted and daydreamy and less hyperactive, we see far fewer girls get diagnosed. And that means many girls grow up to be women who, when they reach perimenopause, as an example, and their hormone levels start to change, and this regulates dopamine, a neurotransmitter involved in ADHD, that's when we see many women start to get a diagnosis, because women are better than men at developing coping strategies. So as girls grow into women, they will learn how to cope and to deal with their symptoms better than men do. And if you combine that with that medical system, which is for years has just really been looking for the symptoms in boys, there are differences in the diagnostic rates. If you look at the biological prevalence, there's not much of a difference between men and women, or there shouldn't be a difference between men and women, because we share the same processes of developing the brain. In terms of outcomes, again, it depends when somebody is diagnosed and what support they get. We know from just reams and reams of research that early diagnosis, early intervention for men or women improves outcomes in multiple areas, in education, employment, relationships, mental health, physical health, etc. So it really is something that is important for us to change, to start to look at women and girls with ADHD as being a group that need more support from diagnosis right through to treatment and management.
Interesting. I wasn't aware that girls are more quiet and reserved when they have ADHD.
It's not every girl, but that's generally...
So how would you pick that up?
Well, this is the thing. The ADHD test itself doesn't. There are other tests that are better. So one of the manifestations of ADHD is something we call mind wandering. And that is, if you imagine you're sat on the sofa and it's the evening and you're relaxed and you can flip from thought to thought, what am I going to have for tea and or what we're doing at the weekend and are we going to go on holiday later this year? And that mind wandering in a relaxed situation is beneficial. You can reflect on the past, the future. When you start to do a task, a part of the brain called the task positive network switches off the daydreaming part so you can focus on the task. But that doesn't happen in ADHD. And that means that the daydreaminess and the kind of being out of the room is because our brain can suddenly start thinking about other things. And we know that there's a test for this called the mind excessively wandering scale or MUSE. And we know that there's some evidence that that test identifies ADHD in women better than the actual test for ADHD. So you can pick up some of those more internalized symptoms by using different tests, but at the minute they are not standardized and they're not used.
Never heard of that before. So interesting. What kind of a role does ADHD play in relationships, if we're talking about romantic relationships?
Massive. Absolutely massive role. One of the most commonly cited issues at the point of seeking help are relationship issues. There are lots of different sides to this, from reduced intimacy, sometimes because the non-ADHD partner feels like they're parenting the partner with ADHD, if they're having to organize them, if they're having to do more of the household tasks. There can be conflict because of things like mind wandering. If you're sat with your partner having a meaningful conversation and your partner just their mind suddenly goes somewhere else and you feel like, well, you're not listening to me, which is a valid thing to feel, that can cause friction. Because of the way in which our brains work and largely around how the brain perceives something called rewards, so how we feel when we engage in a task, people with ADHD are more likely to engage in what's called risky sexual behavior, which is the best 1980s band name that was never used, I think. And therefore, there are issues sometimes around infidelity. And what we generally tend to see is that many relationships where one or more people have ADHD will have issues within that relationship. And whether that's something that is kind of retrievable through good communication, through counseling, etc., or whether it becomes an absolute stumbling block, often depends again on the support that's there. But it is, of the domains of life that ADHD affects, relationships is probably second only to work in terms of its impact.
Can ADHD occur with other mental health conditions?
And not only can it does. So around 80 to 85% of adults with ADHD have what we call a coexisting condition. Now, most commonly that is a mental health condition. So adults with ADHD are around three times as likely to have a mood disorder, such as major depressive disorder or bipolar, are around three to five times more likely to have an anxiety disorder, such as generalized anxiety, or the most common is probably social phobia. More likely to have eating disorders, such as binge eating disorder, which is quite common in ADHD, and more likely to have substance use disorders. Alongside that, those, which I think is really interesting, are physical health conditions which coexist with ADHD. So people with ADHD are more likely to have migraines, more likely to have hyperflexible joints and Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, more likely to have hypothyroidism, more likely to have immune systems and gut or gastrointestinal systems. So for around 80 to 85% of adults with ADHD, it doesn't come alone. And it can be very much complicated by these issues, particularly the mental health issues. If, I mean, I've got all these things. If you have social phobia, for example, in ADHD, it can make going to any event, even a family event where there's a few people, really challenging. And therefore, it complicates the day-to-day management of living with ADHD if you have one of these coexisting conditions.
So perhaps if you do have one of these coexisting conditions, you can get yourself checked for ADHD, and that might solve some issues.
Unfortunately, what we have in the healthcare system in the UK is a lag between the evidence and what practice should be and what practice is. So most people, until maybe the last 2 years, when they would go to a doctor, they wouldn't go suspecting they had ADHD. They might go with anxiety, with depression, with issues with alcohol or substance use. And a good clinician might suspect, oh, let's look and see whether the ADHD is the underlying or contributing cause for this. which it often is, that's not generally what happens. Generally, a clinician will treat the coexisting condition because they're time limited. If you've got 10 minutes for a consultation and someone says, I've got the symptoms of anxiety, well, you know, here's some sertraline or some citalopram. Let's see if that helps. The hope is that in the future, with better training, when a family doctor sees somebody that's presenting with these coexisting conditions and describing a life that could be due to ADHD, that just using an incredibly quick test like the adult ADHD self-report scale or ASRS, which takes 5 minutes to complete and is 90% accurate in predicting if somebody has the symptoms of ADHD, that could change everything. But currently, what generally happens is that those coexisting conditions will be treated and not the underlying ADHD.
So it sounds like we have a long way to go for diagnosis.
We do. We have a long way to go. I'll give you an example of this. So 2013, that's about 11 years ago, there was a poll in the British Medical Journal of Psychiatrists, and it asked the question, so this is psychiatrists, not just family doctors. It asked the question, do you think adult ADHD is a valid diagnosis? And the majority voted no. So in just 11 years ago, psychiatrists in the UK, in general, the majority didn't think that adults could have ADHD. So we've made progress in that time, but there's so much more progress we need to make.
Wow. And can you diagnose yourself online? Is that a pretty good diagnosis or not? I know there are plenty of tests available. Just let's say as a starting point.
That is the starting point. So anybody listening or anybody that knows somebody that may suspect they have ADHD, that test, the ASRS, there are lots of free versions you can fill in online. And they are based on the 18 diagnostic questions, 9 for inattentiveness and 9 for hyperactivity and impulsivity that the diagnostic test eventually would use. And this shortened version of this tool is just 6 questions. And you answer these 6 questions and then it will give you a kind of a score and your likelihood of having ADHD. Now, whilst that is the first step normally in getting an official diagnosis, many people use it for self-diagnosis. If, for example, you know you're going to have to wait 5 or 6 years to get an assessment, but want to start to understand yourself better to try and learn about that identity, many people are, if you like, self-diagnosing and then identifying as having ADHD while they wait for that incredibly long period of time before they can get that official diagnosis.
Yeah, sounds interesting. Sounds like a good first kind of plaster on the wound. So can diet, exercise, sleep, or maybe something else that we can do kind of moderate those behaviors a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, all of the above. So we'll start with sleep because it's probably the most profound impact that ADHD has on those behaviors. Around 2/3 of adults with ADHD have a sleep disorder or a sleep issue, whether it's insomnia, delayed sleep onset, poor sleep quality. And we know that most adults with ADHD, because our brains have developed differently, we don't release the sleep hormone melatonin for about 90 minutes after people without ADHD. So we have this delayed circadian rhythm. And the lack of sleep, believe me, makes every ADHD symptom worse. If you've had a really poor night's sleep, the next day is going to be challenging. So working on sleep hygiene and working on trying to have better sleep quality can improve ADHD symptoms. Exercise probably has the most evidence in terms of being beneficial. We know that it improves focus during a bout of exercise and after a bout of exercise. So regular exercise can be a tool to help manage symptoms. Diet's a little bit more complicated. Generally, people with ADHD have a poorer diet than the general population. We often tend to eat beige foods because they're easy to make, they're quick to make. You don't need a lot of kind of executive function, high-level thinking skills like planning for a recipe and not forgetting that you've left it on the stove, for example. So we generally have a poorer nutritional quality. In terms of diet improving ADHD, there's not a lot of evidence, but having a healthy diet's healthy for everything, really, isn't it? Outside of that, there are some things that we know that can help. So, as odd as it sounds, mindfulness, which most people with ADHD immediately think, well, I can't do that. Well, mindfulness doesn't have to be sitting in a chair using an app. It can be mindful walking, mindful cooking, mindful dancing. But we know that mindfulness and similarly assisted relaxation, so breathing exercises, can help our symptoms because it dampens down a lot of the brain's fight or flight response that we often have. And then for some people, if they're a responder, caffeine. So an effective dose, if you like, of coffee would be 2 cups, and that causes a little bit of an increase in dopamine. So for people who are waiting for treatment or maybe don't want to take medication, then these are things, everyday things, which can help manage those symptoms on a day-to-day basis.
Caffeine, interesting. I would have thought that makes you more jittery and more hyper.
It's interesting because for some people it does. We respond differently to caffeine. So I'm a non-responder. So the coffee that you saw me taking a sip of earlier has no impact on my energy levels or my jitteriness. But for some responders, it does. Some people on ADHD medication have to avoid caffeine because it's a stimulant as well, and that can increase heart rate. But for most people, it's one of those things, particularly in the morning, if you're trying to get yourself into that routine and motivate yourself for the day, it's something that can genuinely help.
And let's say once we finally get diagnosed and we do get medication, perhaps, how effective is this medication?
It's a good question. So the short answer is very. So there are, in the UK, there are 4 licensed medications for ADHD. 3 of them are stimulants and 1 of them is a non-stimulant. In other countries, there are many more. So America, for example, has many more options. And that's largely because the UK's health service is very risk averse and it wants to see really high quality evidence before it will license a medication. Now, those 4 medications are effective in 80% of adults that take them. And that effectiveness does vary. So for some people, it's like a diamond bullet to the brain. And suddenly you think, wow, this is how other people's brains work. I can engage in tasks and I can focus a bit more. For other people, and this is the best way I've heard it described, it just makes you more functional. So it just allows you to engage in some tasks which might be unrewarding more. It allows you to pay attention for longer. And certainly in my case, when I take my medication, which is a form of amphetamine, I can feel it subtly kick in, and then all of a sudden I'm just doing work, whereas an hour before I would be sat there looking at the computer thinking I can't do this. Now, for the other 20% for whom medication isn't effective, or the side effects are too great, or there's a medical condition that contraindicates using that medication, there's very little else. In the UK, you might be offered cognitive behavioral therapy, but the evidence for the effectiveness of that is very low. And that's it. So whilst we know there are the other things that can help, such as what we call psychoeducation, being delivered a course of education on ADHD, ADHD coaching, we know that can help. We're not offered these things routinely. So for most people in the UK, at least, when you're lucky enough to have that assessment and get that diagnosis, you're offered medication and possibly therapy as well. And what's really interesting is nobody reads the leaflets that come with medication. But if you read the leaflet that comes with ADHD medication, it actually says this medication is not intended to be used alone and should be used in combination with other support systems. So we know actually that we should have a kind of a gold standard package of offering people medication should they want it, therapy should they need it, coaching, which can be effective for helping in the workplace and relationships, structured psychoeducation, so to go through a course to help them understand ADHD, but it's just not in place.
So fascinating. It's such a huge topic. I might invite you back for another interview one time. But kind of to round this one up, is there anything that you would like to leave our viewers and listeners with? That perhaps have ADHD, yeah. Or think they might have?
Yeah, so what I would say is if you think you have ADHD, do that ASRS test. That's the first step. If you have ADHD and are struggling a bit, there are some tips, there are things you can do to help you, whether it's with productivity or whether it's with relationships. And often it's thinking about how can I put barriers in the place of things that I'm doing which I necessarily don't want to. So, for example, maybe doom scrolling on a phone might be something your brain will direct you to do rather than filling in the annual report for your employer. But there are apps that can block access during certain times to things that you can doom scroll on. So put barriers in place of the things you might find yourself doing that lead to procrastination, and try and remove barriers to the tasks that you want to do. So try and have a clean office space, for example, try and make sure you're focusing your efforts on tasks during the time you're most effective at tasks. Don't spend it on emails, spend it on doing the actual jobs that you need to do. And those are the types of tips that can really help us at least feel and be more productive in the workplace.
James, thank you so much for joining me today. It was fascinating listening to you.
That's my pleasure. Thank you, Coco.